Let me talk about H2DO4 minus. Electrons are not a problem. Two electrons from two hydrogens. Phosphorus is 5 electrons. 4 oxygens, 4 times 6 is going to be 24 electrons. And then a minus 1 charge, we do what? Add electrons. 25, 30, 32 electrons. The problem is what to do with the skeleton here. And so we have to ask ourselves, where do these hydrogens go? It looks, or it appears that hydrogen is bonded to phosphorus. Doesn't it look like that? It looks like hydrogen's bonded to phosphorus, but it's not. How can I tell it's not? I can tell it's not because dihydrogen phosphate comes from this, phosphoric acid. Phosphoric acid is an acid with 3 acidic hydrogens. If it loses one of those, it forms dihydrogen phosphate. Dihydrogen phosphate's amphoteric, so it could either lose or it can gain. So it's an acid, it's an acid anion. So if dihydrogen phosphate loses, we're gonna form monohydrogen phosphate. And if monohydrogen phosphate loses, we're gonna form phosphate. And so phosphate, however, can only gain. So phosphate's a base, but dihydrogen phosphate monohydrogen phosphate can go either way. And so if it loses or gains, this can go either way as well, but phosphoric acid is only an acid, so it can only lose. That's it. And so this is what we call an acid anion. Acid anions have the hydrogen bonded to what element? The most electronegative element. In this case, it would be oxygen. So these hydrogens have to be bonded to the oxygen. And so what we'll do is we want to avoid oxygen-oxygen links. We want to avoid oxygen-oxygen links if possible. And so what we'll try to do is we'll just try to, the reason we try to avoid oxygen-oxygen links is because they're typically unstable. Sometimes they're unavoidable, like in ozone. Ozone's unavoidable. You have to do that, but ozone's also very reactive. Hydrogen peroxide, there's no choice. You have to do oxygen-oxygen links. Then we fill out the octets, figure out the formal charges. This would be the start. So I'm going to do it like this, the phosphorus with 4 oxygens, and then complete the octets. Except now where do I put the hydrogens? Does it matter which of the 4 I pick? It really doesn't matter. And these don't classify as resonance forms. So for example, if I pick the left and the right one, I wouldn't say the next resonance form would be the left and the top, and then the left and the bottom, and then the top and the bottom, and then the top and the right, and then the right and the bottom. Those, we don't move the hydrogens around, otherwise it becomes a mess. What you do is you leave the atoms stuck in position, and then you just arrange the electrons. And so that's what, once I pick the 2 sites for the hydrogens, I'm gonna leave them there, I'm not gonna move them. And then let's fill in the octets for everything else. And that's what we end up with. Okay, so we got the octets done. Then what do we do next? Count the electrons. So I had 2, 4, 6, 8. 8 times 4 is 32. That's 32 electrons there. That looks good. So this is good. The octet is good. But I also want to check one other thing. What should I check? I should check the formal charge. And so this hydrogen, what's the formal charge on that? 0. This oxygen? This phosphorus? Plus 1. This oxygen up here? Not 0. 2, 4, 6, 7. It's supposed to have 6 minus. This oxygen and this hydrogen are the same as these, and this oxygen is the same as that one. And so we got a negative on these 2 oxygens, a positive on the phosphorus. And so the formal charge is not minimized. Not minimized. One of the tricks to lowering the formal charge is to create a double bond. So I can pick, let's say I can pick this top oxygen or the bottom oxygen and make a double bond. Let's pick the top oxygen. So if I take this bonding pair and make it, I mean a lone pair and make it a bonding pair, say like this, then what does that do to the structure? Now what are my formal charges here? Yeah, zero on everything except the bottom oxygen. So in this structure, the formal charge has been minimized. We can't help not having a negative charge in there because this is an ion. We sum up the formal charges, we get the net charge. We sum up the formal charges, we get the net charge. The net charge is minus one. However, what did we have to do with phosphorus? If you look at phosphorus, now it's got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. It's got more than an octet, which means that phosphorus has what we call an expanded octet. And so we had to expand the octet. Is it okay to expand the octet on phosphorus? Yeah. Because phosphorus is the third period element. So expanded octet on phosphorus, okay. And so in this case, we are going to put some more electrons around phosphorus. However, phosphorus is capable of accommodating those, whereas nitrogen would not have been. You know, nitrogen's in the same family. Nitrogen has 5 valence electrons like phosphorus, but nitrogen cannot expand its octet. And so we have these. How many resonance forms would there be for this? Well, we could have made the double bond up here, or we could have made the double bond down here, and so that means there are two resonance forms. One resonance form with a double bond up here, another resonance form with a double bond down here. Two resonance forms. Well, let's take a look at dihydrogen phosphate. See the images online here. What do you see here? Well, we see that, you know, this is what we're going to talk about in the second half of chapter 13. This is a wedge, this is a dash. So the wedge means it's coming out, and the dash means it's going in. So it's trying to give some shape to it. The shape of it looks like this. You know, the shape of it doesn't look like this. This is all 90 degrees. But we don't care about the shape when we're doing Lewis structures. Not only that, it depends on where you look at it. You know, I have these off on opposite sides, but in reality, it's not on opposite sides. You know, it depends on where you look. If I look at it here, one's coming up, one's going down. The oxygen. But anyway, looking at this, what did they do? They expanded the octet to get rid of the formal charge. Expanded the octet. All right. Let's take a look at all these. For dihydrogen phosphate. See, expanded octet, expanded octet, expanded octet. Expanded octet, expanded octet, expanded octet. Do you see any with an octet? No. All of these are going to have expanded octet. And so typically, when we look at dihydrogen phosphate, this structure on the right is typically what you see. This structure on the right. All except either. Your book, you know what your book is going to have? Your book is going to have the structure on the left. And so the reason I'm just bringing this up is because it's going to be different than what you're going to see online. But is your book entirely wrong and I'm right? No. Because neither structure is actually perfect, because what we're doing is, did I talk about oxygen? Did I talk about oxygen yesterday? I didn't talk about oxygen. Okay.
there's one more issue from chapter 12 that I skipped earlier. We could talk about. And that is this.
Oxygen, it is impossible to write a single Lewis diagram or Lewis structure that satisfactorily explains all the properties of molecular oxygen. So oxygen, it's pretty straightforward. Oxygen, these links are difficult. Like an oxygen-oxygen single bond in hydrogen peroxide is difficult. Ozone looks like this. Ozone's got some formal charges. But, you know, there's a positive here and a negative here. Ozone's neutral, hydrogen peroxide's neutral. Oxygen, though, when we do the Lewis structure for oxygen, it's going to look like this. Oxygen has 6 electrons, and this gives us 16 electrons. We can't have that many electrons. And so after some fiddling around, we come up with this structure for oxygen. We come up with this structure for oxygen, O2. It looks pretty good because everything has an octet, and we use 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 electrons, which is what we're supposed to have, 12 electrons. So this is the Lewis structure for O2. Now this is different. Oxygen doesn't like to form links. It doesn't like to form single bond links, I should say. This double bond is okay in O2. However, this is not correct. It's not correct because Lewis structures are based on a simplified version of quantum mechanics. It's simplified so that we can do these structures by hand. On a simplified version of quantum mechanics. This simplified version of quantum mechanics we could call the quantum mechanics light version. This quantum mechanics light version has a name to it. It's called valence bond theory. Valence bond theory. And so oxygen, when we draw the Lewis structure like this, this is a result of valence bond theory, which is a simplified version of full quantum mechanics. It's simplified to make the theory a little easier to deal with. But in order to understand O2, you have to apply the full version of quantum mechanics. In order to describe O2, need full version of quantum mechanics. This is not the light version. This is the full version of quantum mechanics, which we call, in this case, we call molecular orbital theory. Molecular orbital theory. And so we're trying to figure out where the electrons are and how things are bonded together, you know, where the electron clouds are, this type of stuff. And so this is what what we can get from the full version of quantum mechanics. Let's do O2 structure. You know, it should have some simple, you know, structure like this. This is what we see online, the structure. But it turns out this can't be the structure because it doesn't quite describe the properties of O2. This is why this is talking, why is O2 paramagnetic? Paramagnetic is one of the properties. And so if we go O2 structure, here. I'm doing this wrong, sorry. this, you know, properties of molecular structure of O2, we generate this kind of diagram. This is called a molecular orbital diagram. You can see what's happening with molecular orbitals here. So this is the correct way of describing O2. It's just a bit more complicated. We aren't going to get into it in this class. In Chem 1A, you do. O2 looked like this, 2 oxygen. All right, so O2 is okay. O2, we can form that, but you know, but if we have something like an OO single bond, it's not stable, or ozone, it's not stable. So we try to avoid oxygen-oxygen links. So this is what we end up with here. So let's look at the next example. The next example would be this, ClO4-. What is ClO4- called?
ClO4-
perchlorate.
Yeah. Can you do the structure for ClO4-?
Remember, try to avoid oxygen-oxygen links.